Hey guys, welcome to our Star Wars episode. Now, this is an older episode. This is probably one of a few I'm going to re-edit. I just love the conversation so much. The audio quality is iffy. This is, I think, before I got my snowball bike. But it's me and Patrick basically recapping all the Star Wars movies in anticipation of Force Awakens. There's some spoilers for Force Awakens, so if you're one of the five people who hasn't seen it, now's the time to do it. I'm putting this up for May 4th, but I hope other people will enjoy it. There might be some jokes that don't make any sense. I cut the first half of the episode, but we'll cross that bridge when we get to it. See ya in the episode. Our main topic today is Star Wars! Yes, a week away. From the first Star Wars movie since Return of the Jedi in 1982.
No, it's not. You can deny it all you want, Jason, but there's one between there. I mean,
There's just this
obviously.
block of time. There's no Star Wars, and I know people found it hard, but we're free now. I do have to address that the prequels did come out. There. I said it. Moving on. I don't know. I would honestly. We do have to talk about the prequels a little, and the idea behind them wasn't bad.
Of course. But you know, our boy
Yeah.
George.
The execution, my God. He got so obsessed with spectacles, so obsessed with these actors who, frankly, most of them weren't very good.
No.
I don't care about Hayden Christensen or Jake Lloyd or. By the way, Jake Lloyd, that was an original character I created 10 years before you existed. So you're gonna have to change your name, buddy. Anyway, so let's just go through the movies in order. Order of story.
Brought a lot of strong.
Yeah,
Okay, that's the one.
chronological for the story, not
Gotcha.
chronological anyways. Let's do episode one. What the good now, I've recently heard of the Jar Jar theory that everything he did in the first movie was drunken boxing.
That's an interesting theory.
Well, I mean, it all syncs up. Everything he did had a positive effect for Anakin.
Yeah, it did. You don't think that was just the Force, like, having some sort of effect on him, do you?
No. Most people assume that he was another of Palpatine's apprentices. Which makes sense. He would know who the Gungans are.
Well, yeah.
And then he just magically appears. He leads them to the boss Nass dude. Nass doesn't like want anything to do with Jar Jar. And we assume it's because he's a screw up. And throughout the rest of the movie, everything he does accidentally, quote unquote, actually helps. Oh, okay. What was that? Oh, yeah. Okay. So everything he did helped them out. Then at the end of the movie, he becomes a major part of the Gungan military, who has at this point formed a huge alliance with the human government of Naboo. He's basically because the queen is constantly voted in and out, and Boss Nass obviously at this point trusts him. He's a big advisor. He parlays this in the second movie. Into being Padme's assistant, the senator assistant. And then, finally, in the third movie, he flat out is the senator.
Is a senator, yes.
So, the through line is this whole time, he was working for Palpatine, making sure things that were supposed to go right went right, and things that didn't, didn't. And he didn't need to deal with Anakin anymore, because Palpatine had taken that over. So, while Palpatine's busy corrupting Anakin Skywalker, Jar Jar Binks is making sure that Padme, Panda Bear,
That's from
learns to
Robot
hate.
Chicken.
Yeah,
That's great.
I love that. Seth MacFarlane has a really good Palpatine.
He
What's a Panda Bear? Oh,
Panda Bear or Panda Bear or whatever her name was.
Oh, Vader, don't cry.
Oh my God, he's crying. Oh man.
If in the third movie, instead of having who's the main like because Palpatine was the bad guy in the third movie, but he had a Darth.
Yeah. He didn't really have a Darth. No, because Grievous and
Grievous. Imagine instead of Grievous, Obi-Wan fights Jar Jar, and we find out that this whole time he's been.
Don't do that. Okay. Jeez.
He dropped. No, imagine. And apparently Lucas even admitted, not flat out describing this exactly, but he even said, I had some plans. Fans didn't like where I was going with the character, so I dropped those plans. So apparently, in episode 3, instead of Grievous, Jar Jar was going to come up to Obi-Wan. And when Order 52 activated, Jar Jar was going to go, and they were going to have a fight.
Yeah.
Which I can only imagine would have been 100 times cooler than what happened with Grievous.
Yeah.
But to be fair, there was a lot cut from the Grievous fight.
There was.
Like, he rips through an entire train. Why was it bad in that movie? Like, can you imagine? He gets his gut punch betrayal.
Yeah.
From a guy he's known for, at this point, 20 years.
Yeah.
And realizes everything's been a setup. So he goes and tells Anakin. And Anakin's like, that's ridiculous. It's Jar Jar.
Yeah.
I've known him since I was a kid. Uh-huh. He finds out he killed Jar Jar. He's already kind of like, oh man, not you too, Obi-Wan. So when Obi-Wan takes Padme away, that's what finally pushes him. That Obi-Wan really isn't an uncorruptible Jedi. He's been abused or tricked or something. And that's what sets them against each other. Instead of this, oh, I need to save my wife. No.
So what you're saying is that the story could have been a lot better.
The story could have been infinitely better. And it seems like, and I've seen the comparisons, he does do drunken boxing in the first movie. Mm-hmm. Flat out, he evades punches, rolls.
He evades all sorts of stuff. Yeah, like lasers and all sorts of things.
Jackie
yes.
Chan 101, man. It's crazy. And,
I gotta tell you, I would have probably enjoyed that whole sequence a lot more.
What could have been.
Yeah. Wonder why he ended up dropping that, though. I mean,
because
seriously.
Fans reacted so negatively to Jar Jar.
He usually doesn't listen to fans anyway.
He listens in the weirdest instances, like the Backstreet Boys were in the second movie.
And the what?
They were, or was it NSYNC? It was one boy band. His daughter wanted them in the movie. And frankly, this is something where I was like 15 or 16 at the time, so obviously I hated the Backstreet Boys for no reason. I was angry about this, but in retrospect, I'm like, they weren't going to have lines. They were going to walk past in a temple sequence. That was it.
Yeah.
So I can understand why the Backstreet Boys are very mad about it. And if somebody said, oh, why does Jason get to be in Star Wars Episode 8? He's a jerk. I would be pissed if I got cut.
Yeah.
And I think in retrospect, I could have denied that to somebody because that's a... Do you want to be part of that universe that's immortalizing yourself in Star Wars? I don't know. So yeah, that plot line alone could have saved the first three movies. So let's get on to Attack of the Clones. There's not a lot to say about this one. Every fix for this had another problem attached to it. Older Anakin, terrible actor for older Anakin.
Mm-hmm.
Count Dooku was cool.
Yeah.
But his motivation didn't make any sense.
No.
It still doesn't, by the way, in the extended universe books. Like, he's this dude, he's trying to play both sides.
Yeah.
I'm like, how are you this dumb?
he seems like a fairly intelligent person, but he's kind of getting his own way.
He knew Palpatine's entire plan.
Yeah.
Why would you openly betray the Jedi Order if you know Sith always kill each other? You are expendable.
Seriously. Wasn't he like the first one they told him to kill?
In episode 3, Anakin is ordered to execute him for crime.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Yeah.
Yeah, because Palpatine's
like, what?
Yeah.
Like, you had to see this coming. So Senator Palpatine, what's with that poster of Anakin Skywalker that says, the dream? Nothing. Now, I'm going to have you kidnap me. I want you to hold me on the bridge of your ship. And when Anakin comes in, I'll order him to spare you because you were being brainwashed. Oh, okay. That makes perfect sense.
Jeez, I know, right?
You can imagine their psychic conversation. I thought you were going to have to spare me. Well, I was, but then he grabbed two lightsabers, and I'm like, you have to behead it. That was when Emperor Palpatine and I had one of our famous psychic conversations. Dude, do the mind control thing. I know.
Jeez.
I know you can read my thoughts, boy. Well, no, back to episode two. Episode two, I don't mind the clone troopers. I think it's a good concept. Mm-hmm. Tying it to Boba Fett was dumb. And honestly, it looks like Disney's trying to undo that. From the rumors I've heard about the Boba Fett movie, Boba himself gets killed very early on in his career. Mm-hmm. And some unknown person takes up the helmet.
Interesting.
Which would kind of restore everything. So Boba Fett would be sort of untainted.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I didn't understand a lot of that in the first place.
Okay, so the concept is they wanted the best physical.
No, I knew. Yeah, that was why they did all the. That's why they cloned Jango.
And Jango, in return, didn't want money. He wanted a son that he knew would end up exactly like him. That he could train to be the ultimate. Mm-hmm. Now, they never go into if Jango was a Mandalorian or not, but that seems to be what he was. I didn't read anything about Jango Fett, so I'm not sure if he is a Mandalorian, but that's their whole culture.
Being
a warrior. So that works. That works. I don't like the Boba. See, the Boba is 1-8. We just got rid of a kid. You can make him 13. This cloning has been going on for a while. Make him a little older. Make him capable. Because, I mean, Jango takes on Obi-Wan.
Yeah, he does.
I would like it if... And then he gets beheaded by Mace Windu. And if that's the best you can do for your ultimate Jedi killer robot clones, maybe... Because let's be honest, he got punked at the end there.
Yeah, he did.
So, all the cool stuff he did is wiped out. And killing Jango Fett doesn't make any sense in hindsight.
No.
Ah, so dumb. Other than that, yeah, you're right. The plot of episode 2 didn't make a lot of sense. There's this mystery with Cypher Diaz. And...
I mean, as far as, like, obviously the special effects were awesome.
Yeah.
That's probably, like, the best thing that could happen to that one.
I liked watching Yoda fight.
Uh-huh, that was really cool. I mean, yeah, you can't have a puppet be Yoda all the time. Not, but he's younger than that. He's younger in this part of the universe.
I do understand so Yoda around. Fighting.
Uh-huh.
It kind of goes against how he is in Jedi.
Uh-huh, yeah, that's
but
obvious.
Maybe that's because in his 20 years of isolation, he realized the mistakes of how he acted. Because he gets the military. This is only one of the only things I really like. Is you can see Yoda become this less brash dude. And in the end, he exiles himself. He could have stayed with
the rebellion. He could have, yes. But he sends himself away.
Yeah. And he realizes that everything the Jedi have been doing has been tainted for a long time now. And he has to learn. So I'm not one of those guys who'll say that the prequels are horrible. They're not movies I can rewatch. Because there are good parts, like the Yoda plotline works. If you see him as the guy near the end of his life who's learned from all of his mistakes, that's fine.
The overall plot lines of the first three episodes don't seem to sync up like they're supposed to.
They're all over the place, especially episode two is the worst about it.
It is
because they have to get the clones in. And they have to get a fight in there at the end with Dooku.
Yeah.
And it doesn't make any sense.
And they have to wind it up to where Anakin secretly marries Padme at the end. So they kind of it seems like they're rushing.
I don't know why they needed to get married. What yeah, does that matter?
Yeah. It seems like they were just rushing through a lot of the stuff there. And it just made Anakin seem like a jerk.
Yeah. he's an immature jerk.
You know, we already knew that, because, you know.
Yeah. Because, I mean, even in this movie, he's only 16.
Mm-hmm.
And Padme's like 20.
Yeah. She's like 6 years older than him, so she's like 22 or something like that. Uh-huh. 5 or 6 years older. Yes, she's 5 years older than him, so she's like 21 at that.
This is why I have a lot of issues.
Yes, I understand.
They fixed a lot of Anakin in the Clone Wars cartoon, from what I understand. But his portrayal in the film is really uneven. And you don't get why anyone likes this guy. He's a douche.
Mm-hmm.
He's clearly mentally unstable.
Mm-hmm.
Any Jedi can pick that up. Their whole thing is reading emotions.
Freaking Yoda. Yeah, that's why Yoda said not to trade him in the first place. And then the series of events that Palpatine put into place obviously kept on pushing him towards that side.
Yeah.
So.
I don't know. I think, honestly, episode one, it leaves off in a weird place.
It does.
But it mostly makes sense. It's boring, because no one gives a shit about trade blockades.
Nobody.
But. It makes sense that he would pick something so petty to destabilize the government.
Of course.
Because you look, he's right, there's millions of people in there. They all have different agendas.
Mm-hmm.
It is amazing that there is still a galactic government at the point we see in the movies. Because how do they get anything done? And I get it with a commentary on a Republican Congress, but from a fictional standpoint, you really get that these guys really needed to reform their government.
Uh-huh.
And I'm not saying the Empire was the way to do that.
Of course not. But that was the mean. That was the end. Basically, he was using the ends to justify the means at that point.
And honestly, his plan made a lot of sense. Not the Death Star, but if you put there's territories, i.e., states,
mm-hmm.
and you put governors in charge of the territories,
mm-hmm.
i.e., and then I would assume each planet would have their own elected official.
Of course.
Then you would only need, like, seven... I don't know how big the galaxy in Star Wars is territory-wise. They didn't say anything. But I would assume that's a lot less than 100 billion people in that Senate chamber.
That they have that, the Senate, that's a huge Senate. It really is.
Yeah. The big thing was the inequality against the Outer Rim. They wouldn't have inequality anymore because they had equal representation.
Right.
Yeah. I think there's better ways to handle the politics in Episode 2. I won't disagree that he had a good idea or two. He just, shouldn't have started an empire.
Yes. But that was all about,
he just took advantage of it. But
right.
He was, on the surface at least, addressing issues people had.
Right.
Which is why the Empire got so much public support.
Uh-huh. Especially right after he orchestrated the fight between, himself and Windu,
Three. We're talking more about two, where he's still doing the manipulating. And this is where he becomes the Supreme Chancellor.
Yeah.
And then
says quote unquote emergency powers. Yes.
We'll talk about that when we get to Episode 3, because there isn't a lot of time spent on it. But it couldn't have been any less subtle.
Mm-hmm. I mean, seriously, if I hadn't even seen, like, episodes 4 through 6, I would have even said at that point in my head, I'm like, well, that's stupid.
Yeah.
Why would you do that?
Because he had a meeting out of his hand. It's like, this will benefit us somehow. No, it won't benefit you, I will point out, it did take him 25 years to dissolve the Senate.
Yeah.
So, even with absolute power, he couldn't get rid of that. So let's see. In episode 3, the focus is more on Anakin and his little cry parade.
Yeah, it does.
He had, of course, in episode 2, killed a bunch of sand people. Who cares?
Yep, 'cause they,
And then his shadow looked like Darth Vader for a little bit. That was subtle.
A bit. No, he had killed the Sand People because they had...
They took his mother and did unspeakable things to her. That's fine. There's no justice on Tatooine, so...
No, there isn't.
I don't think he did anything wrong. They would have done it to more people if he didn't go in there and kill them. But they treat it like a super tragic thing that he's turned, but...
Well, you know, it's the...
Who's he going to go to, Jabba?
Yeah,
you gotta do something about it.
Yeah, Jabba's not.
It's run by a gangster.
Yeah,
I don't think he could have. There was really no other way for him to handle it. That's how you handle things on Tatooine.
Right. But of course, the Jedi didn't approve of that because that's not how they.
Yeah, they don't kill anybody at all.
Yeah.
Except all the time. If they did. They committed a crime, a very serious crime, I might add, because
yes,
and apparently his mother wasn't the only other person involved, but I don't know. So at this point, Anakin has been a hero of the Republic. He's cocky. He's a little bit of a jerk, and I like early Anakin in this movie for like the first 5 minutes. He could have, if he had been in the other two movies, I'd really have liked Anakin Skywalker. Because you can see where that attitude would have got him in trouble if he had it in the first two movies.
Mm-hmm.
And that would have been a way for him to be convinced to turn to the dark side.
Yeah.
Because Vader isn't cocky. He's very methodical. No. He very much puts his faith in other people. And that would be a nice turn for him, but I don't know. Episode 3 opens with a big action set piece. And the aforementioned execution of Dooku. And then it's just Palpatine whispering to Anakin for most of the movie.
The whole time. Yeah. He's like,
have I ever told you about the Sith Lords that nobody knew about, but I knew about? Are you a Sith Lord? No. Yeah, have a Sith cookie. I collect them. What's all this stuff in your office? Oh, Sith artifacts. I love collecting Sith artifacts. Oh, well, that doesn't mean anything. I will have one of those cookies. Thanks. Blue milk. And I think this is because Lucas is like, oh shit, I should have been doing this for the past three movies.
Yeah, then he just started accelerating.
He starts it at the end of Phantom Menace.
Yes.
And then he sort of briefly mentions that Palpatine and him have a mentor-student relationship. But it's not in Episode 2 at all.
No.
And he's like, oh fuck, I completely forgot to put it in Episode 2.
Because he was more worried about how the fight between the giant freaking...
Yeah, the big alien robot bug thing.
Yeah.
That set piece is important. On the barf, toxic barf planet. With a gladiatorial arena in the robot factory.
That was...
Good thing that was there. Our final battle would have been really boring. So because he forgot... He had to spend about, I'd say, 50 minutes of the 3-hour movie with Palpatine just tempting Anakin with stuff. You know, your girlfriend doesn't have to die. I could save her, probably. I had an apprentice.
Yeah, which he does, but he just, you know, oh god, I'm dying. just remembering that just cracks me up every time. It's like,
well, I don't know how she dies yet, but I'm sure it's nothing important. We'll save her anyway. And then he's the one who killed her.
Yes, of course he is.
And makes him completely unsympathetic from that point on. Does he beat his wife? He force-choked his wife.
Yes, he did.
His pregnant wife.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever build-up and likability they have for Anakin, gone. In literally 1 second.
Completely unnecessary. Yeah, right when Obi-Wan got there.
Yeah. The worst kind of comic book tripe.
Mm-hmm.
And I love comic books, but this is something they do a lot. They did it with fucking Spider-Man. They did it with Hank Pym It's just something they do to immediately make you hate a character. It didn't work for Spider-Man, by the way.
No.
Thank God. And they don't mention that anymore. But that's just the laziest way for you to show a character has become bad or unlikable. And I think that's when I couldn't stand the movie anymore. Like, and she died of a broken heart. No, she died of being choked.
Choked.
And then having to give birth to twins. Ever hear of a cesarean Oopa robot?
Evidently not.
She might have lived. And you know what? She wasn't supposed to die.
Nope.
Leia knew her mother.
Mm-hmm.
She died young. And you could have used the broken heart thing then. Which is understandable. If you find out the love of your life has become the greatest evil in the universe. So, I don't like that. Because it really it fucks up Return of the Jedi.
Mm-hmm.
But that's nothing an addict can't fix. Poor Jimmy Smith. It's like, all these things he forgot to put into the movie.
Yeah.
Like, oh, I should have Leia's adopted father. Uh-huh. He was the one who founded the rebellion. I better just put him in the third movie for a couple of years. He didn't plan this shit out. Jimmy Smith should have been in the first goddamn movie.
He should have been
Senator Bail Organa. He should have been Padme's confidant and helper. He should have been in all three goddamn movies.
Completely forgot about him.
Exactly. He's in Rebels, the cartoon, and he's far more important there than the movies ever made him out to be. So at least there's that. He has 3PO and R2 do missions for him.
Oh, good lord. This is...
This is going to be a long one, folks, but we're almost done. Yeah. We just the next three will fly by.
What I do like about three, at least, is the gradual state of Anakin's face.
Yeah.
From becoming a.
Well, yeah, they took that from Mass Effect because it's Mass Effect the Knights of the Old Republic.
Yes.
As you do more evil actions, scars and veins pop up on your face.
All that stuff. Yeah.
Everyone does that.
It's like it's not a complete transformation, but it gradually happens throughout the entire movie, obviously.
And the lighting helps too. When he gets on the lava planet.
It does. It does help when you're fighting on a freaking planet full of lava.
And Obi-Wan's face is brightly lit.
Of course.
Because he has a beard and short hair. Anakin has his emo haircut, so his eyes look all sunken.
And
I didn't like he just left him there.
Yeah. He does. He did just leave him there, and he just...
Obi-Wan wouldn't have done that. Even after Anakin did, he would not have left him there.
No.
He would have taken him to the hospital, Palpatine would have found him, and then he would have become Vader.
Yeah, but no.
And that's why Vader would hate him in the first movie. Because he saved him. After all that, he wanted to die.
Mm-hmm.
That's my other problem with the fight. Anakin should have realized during the course of the fight everything he'd done. So that when he did that attack, knowing full well he was going to get murdered, he would fall, he'd catch on fire, then he'd say, kill me, and then Obi-Wan would save him. Because that's what Jedi do.
That is what they do. Or at least that's what they're supposed to do.
And that, that would have cemented Obi-Wan as the character in the first movie who waited for this boy. On the off chance one day he could make right all the mistakes he did.
Yes.
Because at least he would regret saving Vader, but he knew it was the right thing to do. The Obi-Wan in this left him to die. As far as he's concerned, his only regret is he didn't stab him in the face.
Yep. You know, there was something else I was about this episode when Mace Windu figures out what's going on.
How Mace Windu's an idiot? And goes with the guy who's like, I don't know, he might be bad, but why did he take more Jedi? He took two guys, two moved Jedi, by the way, not Council Wars. Uh-huh. Or Yoda, at least.
Yeah.
And then he's like, I'm just going to kill him. Like, no.
No.
Anakin was right. he owns the courts. So that's why the Jedi will hold the trial themselves.
Yes.
And instead, Palpatine lets himself be, shocked or whatever.
To warp his face so that it looks like that, And then he just gets forced thrown out the window. Whatever happened to his body? He just
no
goes
one
flying.
Knows. There's a whole alternate line of books that were pitched that is like Mace Windu realizing how dumb he was, went into hiding.
And yeah, I was going to think that because, you know, Jedi can usually withstand, you know,
though, large... To be fair, they were like literally a million stories up. So
that's true.
He could have hit like 17,000 cars on the way down. But
he did go pretty fast, too. I wonder if he was just knocked out by the Force.
Yeah.
I don't know. That's just something I want to know myself because I'm like, he just goes flying and nobody knows where he is after.
Well, what would have made that scene better is if Anakin was the one who fought Palpatine.
Right.
Because to this point, Windu even says, I don't trust you, man. They've never trusted him. Which, again, something you forgot to put in the rest of the movies. They clearly didn't trust him enough to become a full Jedi. Oh, wait. Clone Wars fixed that. Like, his apprentice in Clone Wars wasn't allowed to become a Jedi. And she seems... They actually used her for something pretty cool. She's a neutral Force user.
Yeah.
So she can tap into dark side and light side powers. Because she doesn't believe in extremes anymore. So, like, again, Clone Wars should have been episode 2. There shouldn't have been episode 2 movie.
Yeah.
But
Clone Wars does fix a lot. It really does.
Like, here's what happened. I think Lucas realized he had too many Jedis that were OP, and he had to get rid of them. Well, I believe Order 56 would kill most Jedi.
Yeah.
I don't believe Mace Windu would have been killed by that. I don't think anyone
no.
would have. So they had to put him up against Palpatine.
Right.
And they could have done a really cool fight. We didn't need the Yoda-Palpatine fight. That was unnecessary. It was basically them throwing chairs at each other.
That was it.
So why didn't Mace get his moment of glory? And Anakin's the one who ultimately betrays him.
Yeah.
After like they have a big fight, he reflects the lightning. Then Anakin stabs him through.
Yep.
That's all you need to do. And then that's when he starts realizing what he's become. Now, I know Anakin's the one who pushes him out of the window. He's like, what have I become? But if he watched that whole fight, a whole meaningful fight, where Palpatine pretty much sees a full-on Sith Lord, and then he does it, that would have been more impactful than, oh, I got shocked.
Yeah.
Well, clearly I'm saving a good old man at this point. I don't know. Like, of all the problems I have with episode 3, his turn is just so unbelievable. Anyone could have directed it better.
And that was still way before, like, the end of the movie, too.
Yeah, that was, like, in the middle.
Yeah, because that was right when they decided to create the Empire.
And which would have been more impactful if it wasn't one Jedi.
Yeah.
They can't even find the body.
Yeah.
And another Jedi is the one who's collaborating this.
Yes.
Corroborating,
yes.
Yeah. And, I don't know. Just so...
And then the movie completely changes from that point.
Yeah.
At that point, it is all about Anakin, so...
Yeah. And it became horrible, because no one likes Anakin at this point.
Nope.
And they never show the movie morally conflicted. There's no reason for him to follow Palpatine.
No.
But then, you're right. Once he chokes his girlfriend, that's it for him.
Mm-hmm.
No one is going to care.
The way he was talking against... when he was fighting against Obi-Wan.
Yeah. I hate you. I'm a 7-year-old little boy who can't get a toy he wanted.
It's like, you're just jealous of my power. What the...
Exactly.
Really? No. Stop it.
It couldn't be him... lashing out against Obi-Wan for all the times he didn't trust him, or all the times he should have listened, or for not saving his mother. Anything reasonable.
Yeah.
Jealous of me for my power. And my secret marriage that you didn't know about, but I assume you did. And then they don't need to show him become Vader.
Like, no,
just
they don't.
At it.
But it was pretty cool that he got his legs and arm cut off.
Yeah. Oh, there were so many missed opportunities in that.
Uh-huh.
Oh, so many. So it hurt. So it hurt so bad.
And then no.
But no. You know what? I would have been fine with that whole scene if he didn't say that. What about Padme? Oh, she died.
She died.
Sorry. Yeah. Like, if he just crushed that entire room with the Force.
Yes.
That is all you need.
Yep.
But you have to pay James Earl Jones the same amount if he says two lines or three.
Yep.
So you might as well give him three. By the way, he can't say no that long because he's on a respirator.
Yes.
So he has to stop to breathe.
No.
No. Oh, Lord. We should just be the two people in the show.
Okay. I think we should go ahead and re-edit the episode 3 to be like, actually.
Well, what I want them to do is just ignore those and remake them.
Yeah.
Get a good writing team on it, and you could have really three excellent. Not even three. I think you could do it in two.
Yeah.
Because we don't need or care about baby Anakin Skywalker. So, start them.
Yeah, you can just say that, you know, you found someone who had potential in the Force.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We can start them off at 15, do the whole Naboo plot, and then go right into the Clone Wars. And say the clones have been something the Republic had been toying with for a long time. There's a lot of things you can do to fix it. I think they would have to do three to keep the trilogy aspect.
Right.
But we already have the Clone Wars TV show, which is canon, according to Lucasfilm, that bridges the gap between 2 and 3.
It does.
Now, if they remake 2 and 3 in the good movies, we'll have really consistent quality for most of Star Wars. So, having said all we had to say on that, have you seen Rebels, Pat?
I see it on TV every once in a while. I don't necessarily watch it. But,
For the purposes of this conversation, Rebels is canon, but it's still relatively new.
Yes.
So we won't talk about it much. I will say I like Ezra. I like his teacher, Kanan, voiced by Freddie Prinze Jr.
That guy, yes. Uh-huh.
I like their whole little misfit crew.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure how it's going to end. Most people have assumed that these guys have to die, because as far as we know, in A New Hope, there are no more Jedi, except Obi-Wan and Yoda.
Right. But no one actually knows that. As far as they know, they don't know. So.
The way to get around this, and the way I think is going to be interesting, they don't have to be Jedi. A big thing that the show does is they acknowledge that the Jedi teachings are kind of fucked up.
Yes.
And like I said, Ahsoka Tano is in it, and she has a white lightsaber, which implies that she's neutral in her Force abilities. So I'm kind of curious to see what they do with Ezra. They're playing him up as something new. He has a blaster lightsaber. Like, he literally can shoot stun beams out of his lightsaber and stuff.
Right.
It makes for some interesting combat when Kanan uses it, because Kanan obviously, he was an apprentice Jedi. He didn't go through the trials yet.
Right, yes.
But he knows how to lightsaber fight, so he can mix it up pretty well. It's pretty cool. I haven't watched, I'm waiting for the second season to finish. And I'm going to buy it and binge it all in one go. Because it's episodic sometimes.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And I don't mind that, but I only care about the story stuff. So. Lando was in it, though.
Yeah. Don't
mispronounce the names. Chewbacca.
I'm Lando.
Hey, Han. Luck? Oh, come on. What do you think, Denzel? Ha ha! They've teased that they might have a young Han Solo. Though, Lando's voiced by Billy Dee. His voice is kind of universal and has an age. Harrison Ford has.
Obviously, Harrison Ford has.
So, Han would be like 26 right now.
Yeah.
It would sound weird. but it wouldn't be so weird. I think they showed Wookiees in a couple episodes. I wouldn't mind if they met Chewie at some point, but not so much Han.
Wookiees seem to show up in a lot of the cartoons no matter what. No,
so. Well, they're enslaved by the Empire.
Yes.
So this was a good excuse to show some.
Uh-huh.
None of them were Chewbacca.
No.
They have, I want to say Grax is his name. He's the concept art for Chewbacca. That weird one with the nose. Have you ever seen that one?
I don't believe so.
It's creepy looking. They worked on that, though. he's a cool character.
Yeah.
I would recommend Rebels. I don't have any complaints about it. It's for kids, so there's some episodes that aren't really... they're not the best, but the majority of it's very good.
Mm.
It explores the fact that Luke, Leia, and Ezra, so far, were born on the day the Empire formed.
Yes.
So, they sort of seeding plots for the new movies, where the Force is trying to protect itself. So it created, at least that we know of, 3 kids to take down Palpatine.
Mm-hmm.
And there might be more, and I'm hoping that, like I said, I haven't seen season 2. So we might be introduced to more, and it would be cool if the story we saw in the original movies was really, really small in comparison to what actually happened.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it would make sense if Luke and Ezra never met, because they would want to keep their 2 most valuable assets as far apart from each other as possible.
Mm-hmm.
You have 2 Jedi left. 2 Force-sensitive people. You're going to keep them in different, very important sectors. So, I'm hoping we'll discuss that more. So, on to the originals.
Episode 4, A New Hope.
Not much to say here. I mean, I think it supports my thing. It's a good movie. It's not the best of the 3. I think everyone can agree on that, but
yeah,
it does everything it needs to do. It makes sense.
It also initially introduces people to what the Force actually can do.
Oh, yeah. We didn't even talk about midichlorians and how they've never been mentioned again.
No.
They don't mention them in Rebels at all. Just so everyone knows. But we're introduced to the Force, something that permeates and binds all living things. Obi-Wan's speech is properly respectful.
Mm-hmm.
As opposed to Qui-Gon Jinn, of all people, the super spiritual guy who just explains it like it's a thing. Oh, they're little bugs.
Yeah.
Which is weird, considering he's the guy who invents Force Ghosts.
Yeah.
They cut his scene out of the 3rd of Revenge of the Sith.
Yeah.
Which is weird.
Well.
Like, he literally explains to Yoda everything that happens, and they cut it. He's like, oh, I learned this on this planet, and now I'm going to teach you how to do Force Ghosts. And then Yoda teaches Obi-Wan.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know why they cut that. I mean, he mentions that he learned it from Qui-Gon, but still.
Yes.
Of all the scenes that come in that movie. So, we're going backwards. Did you see that new commercial where all the people are disappearing and leaving their clothes behind?
Yeah.
Like, no! No!
That's not how it works.
That's not right!
No.
That's not what happens. You don't get teleported into a video game.
Evidently, you do get teleported into the video game instead of just dying, you know? But, whatever.
The commercial is terrible.
It is.
They don't even need to do anything to say, new Star Wars game, buy it.
Pretty much. That's all you have to do to sell Star Wars stuff.
So, I mean, there's not a lot to say about the first one. It does everything right.
Mm-hmm.
You can obviously criticize it, but I don't see the point.
Well, it introduces us to Vader and his ruthlessness, basically.
And that goes back to what I was saying. If he's a guy who wanted to die, who made all these mistakes, and realized at the last minute his only redemption was going to be coming at the end of a lightsaber, and he was denied it, he would become a monster.
Yes.
He wouldn't care anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And then, when he fights Obi-Wan, he's going easy on him.
Yes, he is. It's obvious.
Oh, and at the end, Obi-Wan's like, I'm not going to kill you.
Mm-hmm.
I think that you're still in there. He holds up his lightsaber, and he slices him. And he's like, what have I done? And he gets even more ruthless when he's trying to find Luke. Yep. He doesn't quite know Luke is his son yet.
No.
But he knows he was Obi-Wan's student. And that is his only chance to either kill Palpatine and get some form of revenge, or have Luke kill him. And then when he gets him on Cloud City, he's like, this is my chance. I can die here. And then he realizes Luke is his son.
Mm-hmm. Well, you're still ahead of this, though.
Yeah.
So.
But, I mean, it sets up, he doesn't know who Luke is. He has a familiar feeling from Luke.
Yes. It's obvious throughout the
Luke is a better pilot than him.
Yeah.
Which is, like, his point of pride.
Right.
Even as Vader.
Yeah, that's because the whole time he's chasing him in the thing. Yeah.
So I think, that sets him up for his rather obsessive hunt. The new comics explore him looking for Luke. And they meet a lot more in the comics, which, again, are canon. So pick them up. They're from Marvel. They're pretty good.
I
haven't read Vader's yet. I'm kind of waiting until it's all done so I can read them in chunks.
But there's the part where he goes in and captures Leia.
Yeah.
Just completely obliterates the...
Like,
it was when the stormtroopers were competent.
Yeah. Well, you know what? A lot of people think, and I'm sort of believing this, he ordered them not to kill them.
Yes.
Because Luke was valuable to them.
Well, yeah, I figured that.
He could tell Luke was force sensitive.
Yes.
And Obi-Wan was even more valuable to them. A lot.
Yes, of course.
Because executing publicly the Last Jedi would be like a major coup.
Mm-hmm.
Not to mention, they assumed at this point they were with the Rebellion.
Mm-hmm.
So they wanted them to find the base. And they did.
Yep, they did indeed.
He let them go, and that's why they miss.
Yep.
And you'll notice, they're never really in a situation where stormtroopers have a clear shot on them again. They're always in corridors or something.
Well, yeah. I'm not talking about in general to them. It's obvious that he's not trying to kill them. Yeah. He's just trying to capture them. It's just that when he first comes up across the... when he goes to capture Leia the first time, they just come in and just completely decimate.
Oh, yeah. That's how...
Yeah.
That's why I think it makes more sense that they could have had a scene. One thing he could have added to the remasters is a scene where he's like, don't kill them. Let them think they're in trouble.
Yes.
They'll take us exactly where we need to go.
It's pretty obvious that whole time that's what happens.
Yeah. And that's Tarkin. Another character who's woefully misrepresented.
Uh-huh.
He got a book recently.
Mm-hmm.
And it explains this guy so well that you see why when he tells Vader to stop, Vader listens. Like, this guy that should have been in every other movie after. Because, like, I would read the book Tarkin. It explains... just how much of a monster he is, but why he's so good at being a monster. It's a buddy cop comedy with him and Vader.
Oh, God.
It's amazing. But, yeah, I think it does a good job of setting up everybody, but the Emperor, who we learned about later.
Yeah.
Blows
up a planet.
Yes.
So they try to come back and destroy... then they came up with plans to get rid of the Death Star.
Yeah.
Because, it blows up planets.
There's a movie coming that's, I guess, set during this, where they find the Death Star plans. Because we know that's a big thing in the third movie.
Yes.
Revenge of the Sith. The Death Star plans keep showing up. But, like, they just pass between people and no one cares.
They it's probably not
built
should have
for
kept
20
it, like,
years.
Yeah.
But those plans are probably not going to be accurate by the time.
They probably should keep something like that on the wraps, though,
Yeah. Well, that's the other thing. They never say who built the Death Star plans.
They
was
don't.
It the Trade Federation? Was it Palpatine? They leave out the fact that the laser core of the Death Star is a giant lightsaber crystal.
It is.
Now, Clone Wars, to its credit, explains that. Again, another thing a TV show did, even though the movie is the thing most people will watch.
Mm-hmm.
So annoying. So I think we've said all we need to say about episode 4. Want to move on to Empire?
Yeah. Okay. I mean, we didn't really explore the fact that, you know, after Obi-Wan was, quote-unquote, struck down, he did become more powerful.
Well, yeah, but I mean, everyone knows that. But he doesn't really become more powerful, he just becomes one with the Force.
Yes. He's obviously within in tune with the Force. So he's just an entity now.
Yeah.
Instead of having a human body.
Not a very convenient one, too, because apparently he can't stay very long.
He can't. And he can't. And then and that's just another frustrating thing to Luke Skywalker. They don't really tell him anything. He doesn't tell him anything.
That comes up in Empire, that he lies.
Yes.
Well, I guess Jedi it comes up, but...
Right.
I think that really hurts his character a little.
A bit. Because he doesn't really tell him more about... That's obvious that he's not going to tell him more about who his actual father is. He just said it's Vader killed his father, etc., etc.
Yeah.
And that what brings us into Episode 5.
Yes. The darkest. So dark that it actually starts on a winter planet. You know that the tone is not going to be friendly.
You know, at the Rebel base.
Only one not directed by Lucas.
Uh-huh.
And it shows. As he went in and added all sorts of weird changes and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So, I listened to the commentary for this one.
Uh-huh.
And it was like they were all in different rooms. I would like it if they went back and did one with just the director and somebody who has a personality. Lots of good stuff. We get Lando. I'm sorry, Mondo. Mondo Calrissian.
Gotta remember, though, he's pretty late in the thing, so...
Middle of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
We get Boba Fett.
Oh, yeah, that's another thing we didn't mention in Episode 4 is the Oh, God, Han Solo.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
but
we
you
told
know what? His arc is really small in that.
Yeah, it is, but it's still important because he comes back and helps Anakin to help destroy...
I would say his arc in this movie is better and more important to the character. He's still kind of fighting about from what he really is.
Yeah.
He's like, I'm a scumbag. I shouldn't be here. This girl is 19. I'm 37. Which, by the way, seems to be a thing in the Skywalker
it
family.
I don't understand. It's like...
Stay away from older people. Han's right. You shouldn't be going up there. He's really fighting against being a hero. He doesn't like it. It's not in his nature.
It's not what he is.
But he is a hero. The first thing he does in that movie is heroic.
Yes.
He goes out there and he saves Luke's life.
Yes.
Like, he didn't have to.
He doesn't.
And he risks his own life to save a kid who really hasn't done anything for him. Except get him into trouble.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the first movie, Han just comes back and shoots some things.
That's it.
In this movie, he really earns the fact that he's a different guy now.
Mm-hmm.
The Han Solo who probably wanted to just ditch Obi-Wan and Luke at the first truck stop.
As quickly as he could.
Yeah.
you tell the whole time he wasn't about that. You know? Yeah. He really did not want to be in that whole situation.
Yeah.
Which is an understandable thing because he has a bounty on his head and he doesn't want to get in trouble because, you know, obviously Jabba's looking for him.
Yeah.
So he doesn't want to, like, go all over the place doing all this stuff because he's supposed to be running this.
And running part of the reason he's trying to leave is to protect them, but.
Exactly.
It's more likely that he's like, I can't live this life. It's right. I don't deserve it.
Mm hmm.
And by the end, when he gives himself up, possibly to die. He doesn't know.
Yeah, he doesn't have a clue what's going to happen to him.
He's like, I have to do this for these guys. I have to protect them. And he does.
Mm-hmm.
And I like his arc in this movie so much. And then in the third movie, he's completely neutered.
Yeah. Well, back to like, third, what is it?
We're on Empire still.
Empire Strikes Back, right, yes. I couldn't think of the name of the freaking movie. It's like, God, what the hell?
Anyway, I don't know it.
So, yeah. Freaking. So, they open up on Hoth at the Rebel base there. And just as you said, they pretty much led them right to them.
Yeah.
So the Empire is attacking them and they're trying to defend themselves. You know, big action sequence, flying planes and AT-AT walkers.
Yes, we all play Shadows of the Empire.
Yes.
Younger listeners might not know this, but that was the coolest thing when you were a
It
kid, the
really
first
was.
battle of Shadows of the
My
Empire. Dude,
God.
I can think just like Luke does in the movie.
So yeah. How was I can't remember exactly. How was Luke out in
He went out on patrol.
Oh
And
right.
then a probe droid made it
That's
explode.
right.
And then the Tauntaun or Wampa or the Abominable Snowman
Abominable Snowman thing. He's end up cutting off his
captures
arm.
him. Yeah.
Yeah. He was frozen in the den, so he uses the force to
How did it freeze those icicles around his legs?
no idea. But he uses the force to escape.
Writers in the books always go back to Wampas and make them scarier than they actually were. Like, they start hunting in packs. Like, this tourist company uses the old base as a position to hunt, like, weird ice animals on Hoth. And the Wampas come in and slowly pick them off one by one. It has nothing to do with the rest of the book.
No,
It's just in there, and I'm like, they're not that scary.
Anyway, yeah, so he escapes from that and is out there in the middle of the thing, and Han comes out to, you know, find him. Finds him out there almost frozen to death, so he cuts open his Tauntaun and puts him inside. Does the famous line, "Oh, I thought they smelled awful on the outside." Ugh. So
They realistically should have survived.
yeah, they really shouldn't have, but that actually worked. I mean, they did a lot of Star Wars myths in Mythbusters where they said that probably could have worked.
Well, it would work on our planet.
Oh yeah,
But
no,
Hoth.
they were estimating how cold Oz was, and they actually did it, and they said, and it was plausible that he would survive at that point, even if he was like exposed to the elements for as long as he was. They did all sorts of myths on that one. Anyway, so. Yeah, saves him, then Han wants to leave, you know, not help him with the rebellion and
Evacuation, yeah.
such.
Well, no, because they're getting ready to leave before the Empire
Right,
shows up.
yes.
They're doing the last couple of patrols to try to make sure they don't leave anything behind.
Yes. Causes a rift between the dynamic, you know.
Well, you have to kiss a Wookiee. Chewbacca's married, lady.
Yes. That's when they go to Cloud City after that.
Yeah. Well, no, they get stuck in the meteor belt first.
Right, yeah. They
That
go
was a little
inside
misadventure
the
with the Minox, and this ain't no cave. What I don't get is they have torpedoes and lasers. They
They
could have
do.
just blown the monster's teeth out. It's not
Yeah.
like.
That was like the coolest like animation ever, though.
Yeah,
It's
the little
just
puppets.
the stuff they had to do back then just for special effects, though.
I want to know why Boba Fett waited so long to get them. They
I
were
don't
sitting
know.
there for hours.
It was there the whole time.
I wish they'd do something. Can't
I
pee
don't
in a
understand
suit.
it either. Oh, anyway.
Dad, why didn't I go to college?
Anyway, they go to Cloud City after that.
One
And
more, one
they
more. Is this a ponytail or is this something else in my suit? I forget, I haven't taken this mask off in 10 years. Okay, Cloud City.
Where they meet Lando Calrissian.
Yes. Honest businessman, in
Yes, an
quotations.
old friend with quotation marks of Han Solo.
He accuses Han of cheating to win the Falcon.
Of course. That's where he got
Well, you
this
know what? I
chip.
read the game they played. I'm gonna say Sabacc. And the cards are holographic. Little pieces of glass with holograms on them. And they change value depending on what's happening in the game. So you can put these little things over the card, you go on the tips of your finger, and they'll change the value of the card to the card you need.
So it's quite obvious that he
So
could
it's
cheat.
easy to cheat. Like,
Yeah.
these two are such old hands at it, there's no way they would have been able to cheat each other.
No.
He just lost his, honestly, piece of crap ship. Though, yes. They seem to be in Rebels hinting that he's going to get the Falcon, and we're going to find out why he loves the damn thing so much.
Yeah. Well, anyway, they are quote-unquote guests of Lando at Cloud City.
Indeed.
Where they go into meet.
You know,
huh?
This always reminded me of The Wizard of Oz.
A bit, yeah.
Because they go in, they get new clothes, they get, yes. 3PO even gets buffed.
Yeah.
Then reality strikes in and they have to leave Oz.
Because when they go into the one room, Vader is waiting for them to have lunch with him.
Pull out your gun, Han. Okay.
And then he's
party trick.
Takes his gun.
Well, first he blocks two laser bolts.
Yeah, and then he pulls the gun.
Dude, you know what? I could do this all day, but here, give me the gun.
It's like the craziest thing ever. I'm like, what is going on?
He didn't need to take the gun. He was perfectly fine. But he's like, I better take it. He's going to keep trying.
Now, it's fairly obvious why, Lando sort of, sets him up at this point. Because
the Empire, they're a pre-colony. They're not.
Yes.
I have to think that they're in an uncharted area.
Yes.
Like that cloning facility.
Mm-hmm.
Way back in episode 2. So they aren't under Empire restriction.
Yeah.
Because they're not in their territory. But they're the Empire. So if they want, you're in their territory.
Exactly. The Empire.
In order to keep the place neutral, he has to go along.
Yes. It's completely understandable why he does it. Because he's under all this pressure to, keep this place like this. So.
And people think he's a bad guy because he bitches about the Falcon early on. He didn't want to do this. He had no desire to betray his friend.
No. It's pretty obvious after what Vader tells him when he does that. He says, that's not part of the deal.
Yeah.
The deal has been altered.
Pray I do not alter it.
Pray I do not alter it again.
Pray to who?
Yeah, I know.
Me. Oh, well, I guess that makes sense in retrospect. Can I interest you in a 40 ounce?
I think I can use a bottle of Colt 45.
How am I going to drink this?
Oh my god.
I apologize for the 2-hour episode, everyone.
We're talking about Star Wars, though.
We need somebody to moderate.
Yes.
I'm going to have to put a preface at the beginning. This is longer than normal. That's fine, though. We're doing good. So you're right. And it's all a trap to get Luke, because he knows Luke will sense his friend's in danger.
Mm-hmm.
We should probably talk about Luke going to...
that's right. He goes to
Dagobah.
Dagobah, right, because he was told to by Ghost Obi-Wan. Who doesn't tell him anything.
Yeah. We should go to Dagobah and look for Yoda.
It's like,
why don't we go to Yoda in the first place?
Yeah.
Oh, well.
So,
you know.
So obviously, we're not, are we not sure that Obi-Wan knew he was in Dagobah the first time, or did he
not? I don't think Obi-Wan knew where he was. Yoda can contact, in Rebels they show Yoda can contact people.
Yeah, he can.
Through the Force.
Uh-huh.
But he's hidden because he's pretty much it. He's the only Jedi Master with the amount of experience he has. So they need him alive for their last-ditch effort.
So obviously, it's after Obi-Wan dies that.
So once Obi-Wan dies, he's one with the Force. He finds out where Yoda is.
And he tells Luke.
It's obviously a great amount of effort to manifest as a ghost.
Right.
So he can only do it a couple more times. And he tells Luke about that, and then he saves it for their last conversation.
Yes.
And then looking and smiling.
So Luke leaves his friends behind and flies off.
Yes.
To Dagobah. Crashes on Dagobah in a swamp, gets his plane stuck in there, has to try to get R2 out of the X-Fighter.
Yeah.
Has so much trouble because, you know, it's a swampy area.
Yeah. Well, the whole planet's apparently a swarm.
It is. It's like, that's interesting. There's a whole dichotomy of planets that are one type of freak.
That is something in Star Wars that I think we'd have to discuss on a different show. It just strikes me as lazy writing.
Yes.
Like, an ice planet is something that can occur.
Yes, sure.
A swamp planet, there's it's so not... many weird variables that have to work for that to be a thing. Especially in a super advanced society with spaceships.
Mm-hmm.
There's no way they wouldn't. Because that's vital farmland.
Yes.
There's no way they wouldn't drain that fucking planet and make it.
Anyway, back to the point.
Finally, we meet Dagobah. Yes. And we meet this weird little alien.
Yes. Who talks weirdly.
Yeah. If you don't know. No, you've seen Obi-Wan.
Mm-hmm.
He's an old man.
Mm-hmm.
But he talks about Yoda like he's this badass Jedi nightmare.
Yes.
Of a thing. And we don't know who Yoda is at this point. We do. I think, honestly, maybe kids didn't, but an adult would probably have figured it out. Just when you find out he's Yoda, it still blows your mind.
Mm-hmm.
This little dude. And then he lifts the ship. He's like,
yeah.
Ain't no thing.
And of course, obviously, Luke can't believe it because.
Yeah. And he doesn't judge Yoda.
No.
He doesn't think any less of him because he's this weird little hermit. He's just like, no, this is Yoda.
But it's pretty obvious that it is.
Yeah, yeah.
Because, you know, he uses the Force to lift this,
Once you realize it's all an act.
Yes.
Sort of. You can kind of guess Yoda's gone a little crazy.
He becomes,
Well, you know what? Maybe he hasn't even gone crazy. Maybe this is who he really is. He's finally free of the stress of being, like, Yoda. He doesn't have to be on all the time, and he can be this goofy little dude.
Mm-hmm.
And it makes sense. He hasn't. This is his first student in years.
Yes.
That he's he's excited. He gets to teach again.
Yes. And that's the biggest thing because obviously he used to be surrounded by younger Jedi than he.
That's another thing I didn't want to bring up because we could have talked an hour on it. But
yeah.
I don't like that he was everyone's teacher.
Yeah. But he obviously was a mentor more or less to most people because he was the oldest living at that point because obviously his people lived for a very, very, very long time.
300 years, I believe.
Yes. So, anyway, he gives Luke, obviously, various tasks that don't seem like they would do much. You know.
But in reality, he's teaching him about how to use the Force to make himself more physically viable in a fight.
Runs around the swamp, jumping over things, lifting rocks.
I think that makes sense when you think about it. If you're running around in a swamp, using the Force to tell you where to put your foot.
Yes.
Yeah, that's amazing.
It is.
And, like, the push-ups are just to get his... Like, he has this thing where he thinks he's using his muscles. So,
but it's not.
Yeah, Yoda's like, okay, then get stronger.
Mm-hmm.
And if you feel... And he's right, it's all about how you feel when you use the Force. And then finally, when he's like, even without this, I still can't lift the ship. Then Yoda's like, listen, you have to believe you can lift the ship.
Yes.
All this has been to show you that you can do it. And then he does it. And then, of course, the final test is that fucking cave.
Yep. Where he fights his... What is his biggest fear? Is what it was?
He fights everything. He goes in. His worst fear is Vader. Because he knows Vader is his obstacle to becoming a Jedi.
Mm-hmm.
It's the person who took his normal life away from him. He might not have been on Tatooine if Anakin was alive.
Right.
He would have. he would have... who knows? Vader, in his mind, is everything that he needs to overcome.
Yeah.
And then he cuts his head off.
And it reveals.
And it reveals that because he used violence to defeat Vader.
Yes.
He becomes Vader.
Yes.
And in a way, he does. Right at the end, he gives in to the dark side. That's not true. That's impossible. He's angry at Vader.
Mm-hmm.
He does something stupid, and he loses his hand. And he becomes more like Vader.
Yes.
And that's when he learns he's his father. And that's when he's like, oh my god, I could become him.
Mm-hmm.
Which sets up Jedi really well. And I really wish that the guy who directed Empire directed Jedi. There's some problems with it, but we'll get to that in a second.
There's a few. We didn't even mention Luke's aunt and uncle, did we?
Yeah, they're not that important to the story.
I guess not.
Because all they do is say, oh, I don't want him to turn out like his father. Well, here's an idea. Let him live his life.
Yeah. But they do not.
His father being cooped up on Tatooine for...
Yes.
10 years probably 10 years, didn't help things.
No. They do die a horrible death, though.
They do, but, you know, I think he needed that. He would never have left otherwise.
Yes, exactly. That's how he was able to leave that planet. Yeah. Well, anyway, back to the story at hand. He begins to sense that his friends are in trouble because he senses the Force from, I guess it would be Leia at that point.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, he leaves Yoda on Dagobah, even though Yoda said your training's not done yet.
Now, this part always bothered me, because eventually he says, you have to stop Vader.
Yes.
Jedi. That's your final test. What would he have taught Luke?
Because I don't know.
They both seem to make it very clear he had to kill Vader in the Emperor.
Yes.
But he doesn't. He finds his own way, and I think ultimately that's how he knocks down the old Jedi Order that just whipped out their lightsabers willy-nilly and did kill people because they had to.
Yes.
Luke found...
a different way to do it. So, he heads to... They're still on Cloud City at this point, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so he heads to Cloud City.
They're in the middle of their escape when Luke gets there.
Right.
They barely miss getting Han back. He's been frozen.
Yes, he was captured by them, and then he takes him away. Yes. So Vader's interested in the machine that was used to freeze him in carbonite, because he wants to use it on Luke.
He wants to use it on Luke so they can get him to the Emperor without any funny stuff.
And then
by the way, you know that's your son at this point, dude.
Yes.
Come on.
Yeah, he knows at that point that's who it is.
Yeah.
But he's beginning to set it up. Then the epic battle starts, where he knocks him into the pit, and he starts it up, and he jumps out. And Vader's impressed by this, because he says it. Impressive.
Because he didn't know... He knew of
him. Yeah, he knew that he had Force powers. He just didn't know the extent of his Force training yet.
Yeah.
So, he obviously thought he had beaten him at that point. He pushed him in there. They end up fighting
the two top of the thing. Awesome fight scene.
Yes.
Where Vader just like, I don't even need to use this thing.
Yes.
I am just going to decimate you.
Yep.
And he just starts ripping things off the wall and throwing them
at him. And then at the climactic point, cuts off his hand, and there goes
his arm and his
lightsaber, falls down the tee.
And according to the trailers, that lightsaber will be coming back in episode 7.
Interesting.
So, yeah, I know.
Mm-hmm.
No word on the hand yet.
No.
But I'm thinking probably not. Lefty! This is right hand, I think. feels good to have you back, old friend.
Anyway, he goes. That's when Luke gets, you know, he's in obvious pain because his hand was cut off and cauterized. So he's. Yeah. So he's yelling at this point.
He's getting all his rage and anger out.
Yes.
He's making every mistake he can possibly make. And that's when Vader drops the truth bomb.
Yes, he's like, Vader, Obi-Wan told you what happened to your father. He's like, he told me that you had killed him. He's like, no,
I gotta stop you there because that is wrong. It's no, Obi-Wan lied.
Yes.
I am your father. No, Luke. Luke is never mentioned.
No, I didn't say Luke. I said I am your
father. Oh, okay.
I didn't say Luke at all. I know that's not what he said. I watched the damn movie. Anyway, it's like, no, I am your father. And he's like, that's not true.
That's impossible. Actually, when I think about it, it makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, then at that point, he wants him to join him so that they can rule.
That's what he said. He has two options here.
Yes.
Luke joins him, goes Palpatine.
Right.
Because from his point of view, there's no going back.
No.
He's done. He can't be Anakin anymore. But he can have his son. He can sort of be happy.
Yes.
Or Luke says no right here. And Palpatine's probably going to kill them both.
Yes.
Because he doesn't need Vader if he has Luke.
Yes.
And Vader will never let him have Luke. So he's probably going to have to kill Luke.
Yes.
And at that point, he's pretty much dead, too.
So Luke falls down the huge pit that his lightsaber went down.
Ventilation shaft, I think.
Yes. He goes all the way down and holds onto an antenna at the bottom of Cloud City.
Yeah.
And
contacts Leia with the Force.
With the Force. So she tells Han to go, not Lando, Lando, right? Lando's driving?
Yep.
That's what's happening. He tells him to go back.
He's driving the Millennium Falcon.
Yeah. Picks him up and flies off. Mm-hmm.
Vader's then, they're in one of their space stations. He's got a new robot hand. And they wonder what they're going to do because they're in some bad shit.
Yep. That was a hell of a freaking movie, man. Yeah.
That's why it's the best one.
It is.
I don't think we're going to even talk about Jedi that much because there's not a lot of Jedi to go over. It's just wrapping up every plot line.
Yep. I have loose ends at that point.
Yeah. And Empire is a really good movie. And
yes.
I don't think this director did too many more films, which is a shame. If Lucas had any integrity at all, this guy would have directed every Star Wars movie after. No offense to George Lucas.
He's a marketing genius, man.
Yeah, when he doesn't believe his own shit,
yes.
He is the top-of-the-line best guy in the world.
He freaking played sci-fi. Fox for all the money that they could possibly get, too.
Yeah.
You know, he got the freaking market.
I thought it was going to bomb. Sci-fi was dead at this point.
Man, they really Fox really can't read the mood too much.
He managed to sell a box with pictures on it.
Yes.
For Christmas. And then the toys came later. Never happened again.
Nope.
But still, that's amazing.
It is. Anyway.
So let's get on to Jedi.
Turn of the Jedi, the sixth in the chronological.
I think an unnecessarily long opening.
Yes, it really was.
The test suit's boring, and Trauma could have been on any other fucking planet.
He's still there. He's freaking still in there.
Stomach. I really didn't like. I don't know. I didn't like Jabba's whole thing. The ancient. Apparently, his palace used to be a Jedi temple.
Yeah.
Maybe mention that. That would have been cool.
Yeah.
And he wouldn't care about Force Ghosts or anything because he's immune to that. That's neat.
Mm-hmm.
I just think the desert is such a boring place to go and such a... At this point, he could have done anything for three.
Yeah.
He was two for two. And he picks a desert and the jet... And I mean, Endor is visually interesting. That's fine.
I honestly think Jabba was still on that planet, though, because he already had dominion over it, you know.
Well, yeah, but
he's
a gangster, though. He could be anywhere. I know that they mentioned him in the first movie, but that doesn't mean he has to be on Tatooine.
No.
There's literally billions of other planets.
Yes.
I don't know.
Anyway, he's on this desert planet.
So we go in. Luke has sent the droids as a diversion. R2, as usual, knows what's up. 3PO doesn't.
3PO doesn't know. He's trying to use his protocol aspects to get into the...
Actually, they use him properly. He tries to negotiate, because that's what protocol...
That's what protocol droids do.
And, no, they're given to Jabba.
Yep.
We get to see a robot torture chamber.
Again, that was really messed up.
Yeah, not necessary. We get to see the Sarlacc for the first time.
Uh-huh.
That was necessary, because we need to set up the fight. We get that in the remaster. We get that stupid musical.
That's unnecessary.
Yeah. Leia's already infiltrated as Bosk, the bounty hunter.
Yes.
Then we free Han. Everything goes to hell.
That's when he fights.
He fights the Sarlacc.
Sarlacc, yeah.
And then they just capture him.
Yes.
Clearly, he just killed the Sarlacc. So. Good luck there.
Yeah. It's pretty obvious that he was, like, you know, letting himself get captured.
Luke has, in the interim between the two movies, and we don't know how long has passed, but at least a few months, he has mastered the Jedi mind tricks. He's capable. He's probably...
You can tell he's a lot more capable at this point than he
was. He's comfortable with his powers.
Yes, than he was at the end of the last movie.
Yeah. The whole sequence on the ship is messed. Did you hear about they're not making Slave Leia toys anymore?
Well, I can't say I'm surprised by that.
I'm not either. I honestly, in context of the movie, fine.
Yeah.
As a toy, it's kind of gross and creepy. Yeah.
But you know, there's going to be some people complaining about it.
Oh, people did complain. They're
that's just it, though. Now, this
I
want to
buy these Star Wars toys. I don't want to buy that. Yeah, that's my only option for a Leia. That's pretty fucked up.
This franchise is now owned by Disney. They're not going to really do stuff like that.
They're
going to
take advantage of the fact... Leia was the... When you look, Leia's the only female character that doesn't die in Star Wars.
Yes.
She is. Literally the only one. Her mother, Aunt Mary, her grandmother.
Yes.
All of them die.
They do.
He's it. And I think that's 7 introduces Rain. Or Rey? I don't know. We'll find out. But let's get back to Jedi. So we're on the ship. Jabba thinks he's won. And of course... R2 saves the day.
Yep. That's one hell of a droid, man.
How R2 got past that restraining bolt, we'll never know. But he did, and got Luke's lightsaber. Boba Fett goes out like a punk. He's a blind man. And a Three Stooges sketch.
Gets choked out.
I like that little conversation between Han and Luke. Oh, I used to live here, you know. Yes, this is when we met, Luke. I've known you for 5 years. I remember where I met the crazy old guy and his little boy.
They had to unfreeze him first.
He was blind.
Carbonite.
Because of carbonite poisoning. And he gets his sight back really fast. I'm glad. Because I have a hunch that Lucas is like, he should be blind the whole movie. And just save people by accident.
No.
And at this point, we kind of see that he's become a leader in the rebellion.
Yes.
Like, even though he's been out of action that long. Like, they value his opinion enough to give him charge of probably the most important mission of the whole movie.
Yes.
So that's a nice final evolution to Han.
Mm-hmm.
That he's grown up. He's General Solo now. And he has to get down there and he has to destroy that shield generator. Luke goes back after the whole sandcrawler thing. Zarlak is well fed for the next million years. By the way, Zarlak, desert planet, doesn't seem like the best place.
No.
There's not a lot there. I don't know.
As a lot of people fell into that damn thing.
Well, yeah, unless like Jabba had it imported. I don't know why it's there.
That's more than likely what happened. Weird. You know Jabba's a weird dude, man. Yeah.
Video games, because there's nothing else to put on fucking Tatooine. They put Zarlak pits everywhere.
Everywhere.
They're just sitting there, and like, what? They made it sound like there was only one, and it was quite out of the way.
Yes.
I don't know.
Because what it looks like is like in the middle of the freaking desert.
It's like in the middle of nowhere. It, I guess, takes a long time to digest things. I don't know. It's weird. And Lucas in the commentary regrets killing Boba Fett. He's like, I wouldn't have killed him if I knew he was so popular. And this is pre-internet, so I can't understand why we wouldn't know.
Mm-hmm.
But, man. So he brought him back in the books.
Yes.
Those books aren't canon anymore, so we might never see Boba Fett again.
Yes, that's obvious. Okay.
So, Luke goes back to Dagobah, and Yoda dies.
Yes.
Sad. Does he go back in the cave? I forget.
At that point, I think Yoda just lies down and then disappears. And I think he was in there at that time.
Yeah.
Either that or
he watches him die.
Yes, that's what happened.
Then Obi-Wan comes out.
Yeah.
Ghost Obi-Wan, and he's like, he apologizes for, well, he doesn't apologize for lying.
Yes.
I'm like, come on, Obi-Wan, be a nice guy. what I told you is true from a certain point of view.
Yes.
Point of view.
Come on now.
Fuck you. From a writer's narrative.
That you know what that kind of reminds me of? Freaking,
he's an abusive boyfriend. He lied by saying the truth.
No. You know what I'm thinking of? I'm thinking of the Harry Potter books.
Where, Dumbledore.
Yeah.
Dumbledore never flat out lies.
No, he doesn't. He just doesn't tell him everything. That's what I'm talking about.
I can't blame him.
Yeah.
Do you want to tell him he was right to hold off as long as he did? But
yes.
That's a different discussion.
For a different time.
Yes, yes. So they had that out, and then he's like, there's another, and Luke's like, oh, Leia. Oh, Leia. No, they didn't put that scene in.
Yeah. You
know. Yes, we all saw the kiss, Luke. I won't tell anyone if you don't. But the Force will always know.
Well, at that point, it's not really, he's not really, you know.
Well, yeah, no, how could he have known? But
yeah.
She clearly already knew, because she says as much to Han later. I've always known, even when you Frenched him. Yeah. I wasn't going to kiss the robot.
God. Anyway.
Any wonder Luke never finds a girlfriend. No. So Yoda dies. Luke now knows his true mission.
Mm.
So he goes to Endor. Yep. Ahead of everyone else. And basically turns himself into Vader. Well, he goes with everyone else to Endor.
Yeah, he does. They're here to try to destroy the generator.
I kind of want to gloss over the Ewoks, because I don't care about the Ewoks. But they meet the Ewoks.
They're there.
3PO's, they're gone.
Yes.
Justifying 3PO for two movies.
Yes.
And then he goes ahead and says, I have to do this.
Mm-hmm.
Turns himself in, and then we get the, in my opinion, the best part of Jedi is everything involving the Emperor and Luke.
Yes.
So, they're doing their little mission down there, and it's not going that well. And, the Emperor's watching, and he's like, oh, they failed. You see, they aren't going to destroy that shield generator. And your friends in the Rebellion are going to find out the power of this fully operational battle system. And, like, if you don't know that's coming, you're like, holy shit, it works? And the first thing the thing does is fire and destroy a battleship. He's like, oh, shit.
Yes.
So the Rebellion is in deep shit because this is a big push. They need to kill the Emperor here and now. Luke, at the same time, is in deep shit because he has to fight Vader.
Yes.
And even if he beats Vader, Palpatine is going to annihilate him.
Yep.
Worse yet, if he beats Vader the wrong way, he's going to be twisted to the dark side. And so they're fighting, and he's trying his best to get Anakin to come out.
Yes.
And Vader, at this point, is so far gone.
Yep.
He's like, I just want to die. I don't care anymore. And finally,
you can tell at the end of this fight, that's what's going on.
Yeah. And finally, when he figures out Luke has a sister, Luke loses it, because he won't let anyone else get dragged into this shit. And he sees what he turned his son into.
Mm-hmm.
And he's just laying there. And he's like, I'm going to die, but I've done something so horrible. And then he tosses the lightsaber away. He's like, I won't do this. I won't become you. And then we get the best line in the entire series. Now, young Skywalker, you must die! He just takes like an hour to say it.
He does, like, you must die!
And the Family Guy parody. Not that I recommend watching these, but it's Carter.
Yeah.
And he says it. And he says it just as long. But he even more exaggerated, and it's worth watching just that clip. So then he busts out the Force Lightning.
Yep.
And he's like, well, I can just start over from scratch. And that's when Vader finally realizes he can have his cake and eat it too.
Yep.
And he kills the Emperor.
By throwing him over the top of the thing.
Knowing full well he doesn't really have the energy to do much else.
Yep.
And he's gonna die. And I think it works. Mm-hmm. Like, you can't have him live. He's done too much. Even in the span of the three movies, he's done a lot of horrible shit, or at least condoned it.
Yes.
But in his last act of redemption,
he saves his son's life.
He saves his son. And at least for Anakin Skywalker, he's made peace with himself.
Yes.
I don't quite think that's enough for murdering a temple full of kids or destroying a whole planet. But I'm willing to forgo that maybe those things were a little too much. And he at least made the right choice in the end.
Yes.
Which doesn't negate him as a villain or anything. I think it works as his, like, the only way he can redeem himself is to save his son.
Yes.
Because he doesn't want to live. He's never wanted to live. Not since...
Padme died, yes.
So I think it's a good wrap-up for the character.
Mm-hmm.
And then we get the song. The rebellion wins, and we get Yub Yub.
But we forgot about the destroyed his shield generator, so obviously Death Star. Yeah.
Han manages to blow that sucker up.
Yep.
And that is the end of the Empire. Well, no, it isn't realistically. It's a government structure. They have backups, but...
It's really funny how they talked about that in the Family Guy version. I was like, yeah, I guess we lose. Like, what are you talking about? There's still... Nope, we lose.
Apparently, that's an area they haven't covered in the fiction yet, so we don't know exactly what happens after the battle of Endor. We do know that a nuclear holocaust rains down in the next couple days on the Ewoks, so...
Yes.
So that's something. we didn't mention it's a trap. I think we all knew that goes without saying.
Yes. Admiral Ackbar.
That's a trap.
He had lots of lines in the movies, but that's the only one anyone.
No, this is Ackbar only appears in the third one. I don't think he's in the second.
Yeah, just the third one.
There's no aliens in the rebellion until the budget increases.
Yeah.
So that wraps it up for the original and the prequels.
Yeah.
Maybe we'll talk about toys later, but I might get that BB-8 after Christmas when I see some clearance sales. It's $150 right now.
Yes, it is. It's expensive.
For as small as it is.
Yeah.
Knowing full well my dogs will kill it. I can't justify $150.
It is cool, though.
Yes, it is. There's two versions. You have to make sure you get the $150 one, because the other one is just got wheels on the base instead of just the whole ball spinning.
Whole ball spinning.
Yeah. But yeah, I think that'll wrap it up for the day. Thank you for listening to Nerds at Lunch. If you liked what you heard today, please like and subscribe, and share with your friends. You can find us on Twitter at King Riptor. That's my personal Twitter account. I'll post new episodes there as they come up. You can join our Facebook page, facebook.com/robothousepodcasts, or you can follow Steve, who may or may not be on today's episode, on facebook.com/otakuhenshin or otakuhenshin.com for his store. And we will see you next week.